right, good evening, church family. Welcome tonight to our Sunday night service. Would you stand with us as we begin our time together as we come before the Lord with thanksgiving and worship Him? Let's pray. Father, we delight in who You are. We delight in Your presence. Thank You for all that You've done and all that You are doing. We trust in You. Tonight we want to come and just feed on Your faithfulness to sit with Your truth and to be transformed in our minds by the powerful Word and by Your Spirit. So would You inhabit the praises of Your people now as we worship You, as we respond to all of Your goodness, and we give You glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
This life we lead, enthroned upon the praises of a thousand generations. You are worthy, Lord of all. And unto you, the slain and risen King, we lift our voice with heaven, singing, worthy, Lord of all.
The fullness of God won't be kept in.
So here it is, my alabaster heart, I'm keeping nothing back from who you are. No hidden treasure veiled by key or lock. Your lifetime worth the worship, and it's only just the start. My every waking day, the minutes, hours, the years of endless praise. For you worthy far beyond all I could say. There's a lifetime worth of worshiping the nuance of your names. So let it rise like incense. My whole life, a fragrance, every ounce here broken at your feet. Every breath, an offering, my heart cries, these long sing over you, my worthy King of Kings. Cross, giving all you are for all I'm not. I can't believe that's the kind of king you are. How could I not bring a lifetime worth of worship to you, God? So let it rise like incense, my whole life. Fragrance every ounce here broken at your feet. Every breath in offering, my heart cries, these lungs sing over you, my worthy King of Kings. So let it rise, so let it rise like incense, my whole life. The fragrance every ounce broken at your feet. Every breath can offer, my heart cries, these lungs sing over you, my worthy King of Kings. Have it all my love. incense, my whole life a fragrance, every ounce here broken at your feet, and every breath an offering, my heart cries these long singing over you, my worthy King of Kings. Sing it in, so let it rise like incense, my whole life a fragrance, every ounce here broken at your feet, and every breath an offering, my heart cries these long singing over you, my worthy King of Kings. Something isn't adding up, this wild exchange you offer us. I gave my worst, you gave your blood, seems hard to believe. You're telling me you chose the cost, you're telling me I'm worth that much. That's the measure of your love, how else would I sing? But I'm completely, deeply, sold out, sincerely abandoned. I'm completely, freely, hands to the ceiling in ember. Consider it yours, Lord. Consider it yours, Lord. The failures I hide, the victories I don't, the battles I fight, each now that I hold. Consider it yours, Lord.
And God, that's our desire tonight, that we would live our lives in complete surrender to you. We know that we fall short each and every day, and we are in need of your grace and of your mercies, your forgiveness. But thank you that you are a God who is slow to anger and abounding in love. Pray tonight that we would draw closer to your heart, that you would break our hearts for the things that break yours, Lord. We want to give all to you, so we're here and we're asking, Lord, that you would show us your glory, that you would renew a right spirit within each of us. We love you so much, and we thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
You may all have a seat. Real quickly, how many were here this morning? Oh, all right. Good to see all the returnees. But those of you that weren't here, let me give you a little bit of a background on our guest speaker this evening, Dr. Jason Lisle. Incredible. If you weren't here this morning, you missed a really, really wonderful study on the Genesis account. I would encourage you to go to our website and archive the study he did this morning. It will bless you immensely. But I was so filled with what he had to share, because what he shared this morning is really relevant when it comes to our faith and the belief of the gospel. So, but Dr. Lisle is a Christian astrophysicist who researches issues pertaining to science and the Christian faith. Dr. Lisle presents a rational defense of a literal Genesis, showing how science confirms the history recorded in the Bible. Dr. Lisle double majored in physics and astronomy, along with a minor in mathematics at Ohio Wesleyan University. He went on to obtain a master's degree and a PhD in astrophysics at the University of Colorado in Boulder. Dr. Lisle has dedicated himself to full-time apologetics ministry. He wrote a number of planetarium shows for the Creation Museum. In fact, we are talking, and my wife and I went to the Creation Museum last summer and actually saw some of the work that he did, which is phenomenal. So if you've never been to the Creation Museum or the Ark, go. You'll be in for a treat. And he is also the author of a number of best-selling books related to creation, such as Taking Back Astronomy, The Ultimate Proof of Creation, Discerning Truth, Stargazer's Guide to the Night Sky, and Understanding Genesis. Now, unfortunately, what you see on the table, that's it. We got wiped out first service, literally. And what's left, they bought up some from second. So whatever's out there, I would encourage you, grab what I think. They can go and order the packet still. So you'll see our secretary in the office, and they have a packet they can put together for you, and they will send it to the church if you're interested, and I would definitely get it. He's also the founder of the Biblical Science Institute. So let's give our guest speaker this evening a nice, warm aloha, Dr. Jason Lisle.
All right, well, it's very good to be back with you this evening, and I get to talk about my specialty field of astronomy. It's something that I very much enjoy, and it's something that has been misused. The field of astronomy has been misused to try and persuade people that the Bible's not true, and I find that sad, and as a Christian astrophysicist, it makes me angry, to be honest with you, because there's this narrative that, well, we know scientifically that the universe exploded into existence 13.8 billion years ago, and then galaxies evolved, and planets evolved, and on one of them life evolved, and that became you. Well, I would reject that story, and that's all it is a story about the past, in favor of the recorded history that we have in Scripture, and not just any history that's written by inspiration of God and is therefore true. The Bible does have some things to say about outer space. And when it says those things, it's right, because it's God's word. See, some people say, well, you know, what do you look into the Bible for if you want to do astronomy? Well, that's the best place to start, because we start with certainty from God's word, and then we can build on that and learn things. And, you know, people say, but the Bible's not an astronomy textbook. That's true, because astronomy textbooks change every few years, and we got some things wrong, and we have to update them. But the Bible will never have to be updated. I mean, there might be newer translations and things like that, but the facts, it got right from the beginning, because it's the Word of God. And so what I want to do this evening is give you some information that you can use, that you can share with your friends, your coworkers that are maybe not open to Christianity, to maybe get them to think a little bit. And so this is conversation starters, I think. It's a good way to open the door to someone who has been convinced that science is to be scientific is to be anti-Bible, because nothing could be further from the truth. We're going to see this evening that the secrets of the cosmos confirm the Bible. They really do. And there are four secrets of the cosmos we're going to discuss this evening. The first is how the glory of God is revealed in his universe. And it really is. When the Bible addresses the fact that the universe declares God's glory, not random chance, not a big bang, not accidents. No, it's glorious because it's God's glory that's being revealed there. The Bible's right about that. We're going to see that the Bible is right when it teaches about the basics of astronomy. There are certain things that you would learn in a freshman-level astronomy class that the Bible states, and it got those things right. And we'd have to admit that it got it right. We're going to see that the Bible is right when it addresses the age of the cosmos. We addressed that from a theological perspective this morning. I want to look at some of the science this evening. The Bible's right about the age of the universe. And we're going to see the Bible is right about the uniqueness of Earth. Earth is not just another planet out there. It's very special in God's plan. Very, very special. And so in all these cases, the Bible got it exactly right. And we'd have to admit that the Bible got it right. And of course it would, because it's God's word. Of course it would. So let's jump right in and see how the glory of God is revealed in the universe. It's something the Bible teaches in Psalm 19:1. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. That's that beautiful synonymous parallelism that's indicative of Hebrew poetry. You'll see a lot of that in the Psalms and in the Proverbs. And so it's not that the heavens are literally saying anything about God, but they do tell us something about God. When we look into the heavens, we can't help but be reminded of God's power and majesty. It's in that sense that they declare or proclaim the work of his hands. Now, there are many ways in which the heavens declare God's glory. I'm just going to stick with two this evening because that's frankly all we have time for. I'm going to argue that the incredible size of the universe is a testament to God's power and ingenuity and the beauty of the universe. Those are the two aspects of the universe that I think are not consistent with what you'd expect if it was just kind of an accident. The size and the beauty of the universe. Now, the beauty of the universe, you don't have to be a PhD astrophysicist to appreciate that. You can go outside on a clear night, look up, and it's amazing what you can see if you get away from the city lights, of course. And there's just such beauty out there. And we're very blessed to live in a time where we have instrumentation like the Hubble Space Telescope and now the James Webb Space Telescope that can deliver these beautiful images because they're both above Earth's atmosphere, and which creates a blurring effect. They don't have that. And so you get these crystal clear, beautiful images of space that our ancestors could only have imagined. And we now have them in detail. What a blessing. And they're beautiful. They are beautiful. Just go on the internet and Google Hubble images, and you'll get all kinds of wonderful results for that. Now, the size of the universe, that's hard to comprehend. And I dare say nobody really comprehends it. Now, thanks to scientific notation, we can write down numbers in a very small space that express the enormous distances involved. And we can even measure those distances using various techniques, but to really grasp them, you can't. To really get a feel for it, the best I can do is compare things to other things and kind of give you a feel for just how big the universe is. And I think you'll be impressed with it. God made a magnificent universe. It's beautiful. And it's enormous beyond our comprehension. We're going to start with the moon. The moon is about the same size as the continental United States. If you were to put the United States up at the same distance as the moon, it would cover about the same area. You say, really? It looks awfully small. I can cover it up with my finger. That's because it's 240,000 miles away. That's how big the continent would look if it were 240,000 miles away. Now, that's a big distance, but it's a distance you can kind of get your head around, kind of. Some of you, if you have a really good car, it might have 240,000 miles on it. So that gives you kind of a feel. So you could theoretically have driven the distance to the moon, though probably not back. Okay, so that gives you a feel for how big and how far away that is. The moon is our next door neighbor, cosmically speaking. 240,000 miles, that's nothing. And again, we have these wonderful pictures of the moon. I love showing people the moon through a small telescope because they look at it and it has a beauty to it. It's a desolate beauty, but it is beautiful, especially when it's in the first quarter phase, when it's illuminated right down the middle. This is kind of where it's full and you can't see the craters as much when it's full like that. And one of the questions that people ask is, well, can you see the flag that the astronauts planted? Well, that's the size of the continental United States. You're not going to see anything that small, not from Earth-based telescopes. But we did have a spacecraft orbiting the moon, the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, and it took very high-resolution images of the moon. And that's, in fact, a mosaic image of those combined. And it's in such detail, we can actually see where the astronauts landed. I want to show you this because I think it's amazing. We're going to zoom in here on Mare Tranquillitatis, the Sea of Tranquility. These are called seas because in ancient times, they literally thought they were seas. They thought they were oceans, these dark areas. This is why they're called maria, the Latin for seas. We now know they're made of basalt, so there's no water on the moon. If we keep zooming in there on the lower portion of the Sea of Tranquility, and you can see some craters there and some interesting features as we continue to zoom in, higher and higher resolution. To get to a little spot in the center there and zoom in on that. And one more time. And that is the location of the first moon landing, the Apollo 11 structure. And the lower section of the spacecraft is still there. Remember when they took off from the moon, they left the lower portion of the spacecraft to save fuel. So they just, you know, launched the top portion. So we pollute everywhere we go. So there's some junk left on the moon and some other instruments that they left on the surface. And you can see some of those there indicated. There's that dark streak that you see going over to that crater and back. That's the footprints of the astronauts as they walked over to that crater and back. So 50-year-old footprints, pretty neat. And they're not going anywhere because there's no air on the moon. So it's just, it's a dusty surface. There's no maid service. So those footprints are going to be there for a very long time. So pretty neat. And we've documented the other sites as well. And you can still see the spacecraft where they've landed. And in all but this one, you can even see the flag, or at least the shadow the flag casts, because they're kind of vertical, right? For this one, you don't see the flag because it got knocked over when the spacecraft took off. And Buzz Aldrin was able to see that out his window. So they learned to put the flag a little further away from the spacecraft from then on. Here's the moon in a first quarter phase where it's illuminated right down the middle. And it's so gorgeous to look at it in that phase because your brain can tell it's a sphere. When it's full, it looks flat as a dime. But when it's illuminated like that, from the way the light interacts and produces shadows on the craters, your brain immediately is able to figure out that's a sphere. And so it's not only a testimony to how beautiful the moon is, but to how amazingly well-designed the human brain is. We don't often use it properly, but God made an amazing computer in your skull made out of meat, and I think that's amazing. I think that's cool. And it's able to do trigonometry just like that, to at least give you the shape of the moon. So that's pretty neat. So here's the moon compared to the Earth. And Earth's pretty big. Earth's pretty big. And I'm reminded of that. I'll be reminded of that tomorrow when I make a trip back to the mainland. I'll be like, man, the Earth's big, because this has just taken so long. There's just a lot of ocean, and it is big. It's a big planet, and that's wonderful. But it's small compared to some of the other planets that the Lord made, like Saturn. Saturn is 9 times the diameter of the Earth, and that's just the planet. The rings, which are trillions of tiny little moonlets orbiting around Saturn's equator, they extend even farther out into space, and they give Saturn that unique and beautiful appearance. And Saturn's another one I enjoy showing people in a small telescope, because you can see the rings, and they're beautiful. But it looks like it's about that big. You just want to grab it and stick it in your pocket and take it home with you. But you can't, because it's 9 Earths across. And the reason it looks like that, even in a telescope, is because it's 1 billion miles away. And at that point, I'm done, right? I mean, I can't comprehend that. I can kind of get my mind around 240,000 miles. 1 billion miles, done. I can't comprehend that. But at least, you know, you say, well, at least we got some big planets in our solar system, and Saturn is pretty big until you compare it to the sun. The sun is over 100 Earths across. And in fact, you see those little black spots on the sun. We call those sunspots because we're not very creative, apparently. And, you know, you could fit Earth right in one of those. Those are just cooler regions on the sun, and so they don't glow as brightly. They're actually glowing. They just, by contrast, they look dark. So the sun is what we call a main sequence star. The sun is a star. Yeah, those little tiny blips you see in the night sky are the same kind of object that the sun is. They're just much further away. The sun is relatively close. It's 93 million miles away. How long would it take to drive 93 million miles at, let's say, 65 miles an hour? It's something like 160 years. So you couldn't do it in your lifetime, and that's without stopping for bathroom breaks and things like that. So you couldn't get to the sun in your lifetime. That's pretty amazing. Now, the sun is bigger than most stars. So you say, we've only got a pretty big star, and that's true. Some of our next-door neighbors, like Proxima Centauri, is quite a bit smaller than the sun, although still much bigger than Earth. All stars are bigger than the Earth. All true stars, all main-sequence stars, are bigger than the Earth. There's Wolf 359. It's pretty small, but bigger than Earth. All smaller than the sun, though. But there are some stars that are much bigger than the sun, like Mintaka, for example, which is one of the stars of Orion's belt that you can see high in the sky this time of year. So there's Mintaka, a blue supergiant. Now, there are stars bigger than Mintaka. For example, Canopus, which you see kind of in the southern sky this time of year. It's a white supergiant. Look how much bigger it is than the sun. I mean, the sun's just a blip now. And remember, the sun's 100 Earths across. So that's enormous. And Canopus is small compared to Antares, which is a star that you see in the summer sky. And Antares is over 600 suns across. It's enormous. And so it gives you a feel for just how big some of these things in space get, and therefore the power of the Lord to speak these things into existence. If you were to take Antares and put it where the sun is, we would be inside it. It would extend all the way out, way beyond the orbit of Mars, almost out to Jupiter's orbit. Pretty impressive. So there's the inner planets of the solar system. The outer planets orbit much further out. There they are. In fact, you could put all the classical eight planets in a, they would all fit in a box that's 6 billion miles on a side. That's kind of the size of our solar system. There's other stuff orbiting beyond that, but those are the planets anyway. Now, the next largest object is quite a bit bigger than that. We can zoom out by a factor of 10, so now we're at 60 billion miles. We can zoom out by another factor of 10, so we're at now 600 billion miles. And at this scale, you start getting the next largest object out in space, which would be a nebula. Isn't that lovely? That's the Julebug Nebula. A nebula is a cloud of hydrogen and helium gas spread out in space. They're made of the same stuff stars are. Stars are hydrogen and helium gas, but stars are kind of compact in a sphere that's and held together by their own gravity, whereas a nebula is spread out over a vast region of space. And so it's very thin, it's very rarefied gas. And if there are stars nearby, they'll make that nebula glow. And you get these beautiful colors in many cases. So nebulae are very colorful. And there is a little star in the middle of that one, and that's what's causing that gas to glow. The star has ejected its outer layers of gas. This is what we call a planetary nebula. So they all have, it has nothing to do with planets, by the way. They all have a star in the middle. Here's another one, the Ring Nebula, and it has a little star in the middle. The star has collapsed in on itself, become what we call a white dwarf, but it left this lovely parting gift, this lovely expanding shell. And that's about a light year across. So you've probably heard that term before, light year, and people think, well, that means time because it's a year. But no, it's actually a distance. It's a distance of about 5.88 trillion miles. And again, at that point, we can't really have a feel for that, how big that is. But that's kind of a neat reminder because you can see this little guy in a small telescope not too far away from the star Vega in a summer evening sky. And you can point a small, even a modest telescope will see it if you get to dark skies. It looks like a little glowing smoke ring. You won't see the colors so much because at night you're using your night vision, you're using your rods rather than your cones, and the rods can't detect color. They're grayscale. But it'll look like a gray version of that. It's really weird to see that little glowing smoke ring there hanging on nothing. You're expecting it to expand, and it is expanding. It's just huge. And so it takes centuries for it to grow any substantial amount. Some planetary nebula have a bipolar structure where the star is ejecting gas out the poles, the north and south pole of the star, we think, and creates sort of a dual bubble. So those are quite pretty as well. Planetary nebula are the smallest type of nebula. Some nebula are much bigger, like this one. This is the Horsehead Nebula. And that spans, if you take the whole nebula, it spans about 22 light years across. 22 times 5.88 trillion is a lot of miles. It's really big. And this is where, again, you have a cloud of gas. It's just there's not one individual star associated with this one. There are several stars around there heating it up, causing that gas to glow, and you get these beautiful colors. But there are objects that are bigger than that, like globular star clusters. I love these things. There are two types of star clusters. This is my favorite. This is the globular cluster, and they're a sphere, roughly spherical region, of hundreds of thousands of stars in a span of space that's, you know, maybe, you know, 50 to 100 light years across. So they're just stunningly beautiful. And you can see these in a small telescope if you know where to look. There's one called Omega Centauri, which is one of the best ones that you can see. And it's spectacular. And it reminds me of that verse. There's a verse that says that God calls them all by their names. God has a name for each and every one of those little stars. Each one of those is like the sun. Some of them are bigger. That's an amazing thing, isn't it? Because we don't even know exactly how many stars there are there. And God has a name for each one and therefore a purpose for it. And that's one globular cluster. Our galaxy has a few hundred of these kind of orbiting around its center. And so everything we've looked at so far, moon, stars, nebulae, star clusters, are part of a much, much larger structure called a galaxy that just dwarfs everything else we've seen so far. So there's a galaxy. So we're in a structure that looks something like this. Now, this is a different galaxy. It's not ours. We don't have a picture of ours from the outside because nobody's been outside other than God, okay? And he hasn't shared any selfies or anything like that. So there you go. But that's our structure. Our galaxy looks something like that. It's a spiral galaxy. Some galaxies kind of elliptical, others are spirals. And they're stunningly beautiful. What you're seeing there is a collection of about 100 billion stars. And how long would it take to count to 100 billion? A long time. To count to 1 billion would be something like 30 years. So you couldn't count the number of stars in this galaxy in your lifetime. And again, God has a name for each one. That's pretty impressive. In fact, there are so many stars there, they blend together. And in older astronomy textbooks, they called these spiral nebulae because they thought they were clouds of gas because they didn't realize, no, it's 100 billion stars. But with the older telescopes, they couldn't see individual stars. With the newer ones, we can. Some of the brighter stars, we can actually see them. So pretty impressive. Now, in the early 1920s, most astronomers thought our galaxy was the only one. They could see these, but they thought they were relatively near. They thought they were small and in our galaxy. They didn't realize they were other galaxies. And we now know that there are at least 100 billion galaxies in the universe, one for every star on our own. Galaxies sometimes come in clusters, like this wonderful cluster here. This is Stefan's Quintet, and you can see this with a substantial backyard telescope. If you know right where to look, you can see five galaxies there, absolutely stunning and beautiful. And four of them are genuinely part of a cluster, and then there's one that's actually way in front of them, and it's the one that's bluer. It's actually much closer than them. So it's not part of the cluster. It's kind of photobombing the background galaxies there. It just happens to be in the way. But very pretty, very stunning. As we go out deeper into space, you see galaxies upon galaxies. Those are not individual stars you're seeing there. Those tiny little specks are galaxies, each one containing perhaps 100 billion stars. Some less, some more. Isn't that amazing? That's the Hubble Ultra Deep Field. That was about as far as we could go out until recently. And even this was surprising to secularists because you see, in the secular view, they believe in a big bang that happened 13.8 billion years ago, and then galaxies formed from that initial gas. And so the secularists say, as you look out into space, it's kind of like looking back in time because it took the light a long time to get from there to here. That's not necessarily true because Einstein tells us there's more than one way to define what you call now out in space. I won't get into that. It's a little bit tricky, but in any case, in the secular view, they were expecting that as you look out into space, you're looking back in time. You should look back to a point where there aren't any galaxies yet, because they haven't formed yet. And so this was a little bit surprising. And that's one of the reasons they developed the James Webb Space Telescope, which is a wonderful instrument. It is a brilliantly designed space telescope. It's bigger than Hubble, and it's able to see farther out into space because galaxies are redshifted. The farther away they are, their light gets shifted downward to the point where we can't even see them anymore. It's kind of down in the infrared. Well, James Webb is designed to look in the infrared, so it can see galaxies at tremendous distances beyond what Hubble could see. And the secularists wanted this telescope to confirm the Big Bang. They were expecting that galaxies that are really far away should be kind of baby galaxies, because you're looking back in time to when galaxies were very young, and you ought to look out to a certain distance where there aren't any galaxies. And so secularists made several predictions about what the James Webb Space Telescope would detect. First of all, they predicted fewer galaxies at great distances, right? Because galaxies form over time. If you look back far enough, you shouldn't see very many, and you shouldn't see any beyond a redshift of about 14. Redshift indicates how far away it is. So that's kind of their prediction. At a redshift of 14, the galaxy should stop, because in their view, that corresponds to a time less than 500 million years after the Big Bang, and galaxies are supposed to take longer than that to form. So you shouldn't see any galaxies beyond that distance, if the Big Bang's true. They were also predicting that the farthest galaxies that you do see should be baby galaxies, right? They should be low mass and kind of clumpy and irregular, because it takes time for them to grow and become these beautiful spirals in the secular view. And they were predicting that the farthest galaxies would have no what are called heavy elements. Now, in astronomy, a heavy element's anything heavier than lithium. So you got hydrogen, helium, lithium, and then everything else is a heavy element. Now, the Big Bang is only supposed to produce hydrogen, helium, and lithium. That's the only thing the Big Bang is supposed to be able to produce. Therefore, what should the first stars be made of? Hydrogen, helium, a little bit of lithium, because those are the only atoms available. And then some of those stars are supposed to fuse and make heavier elements in their core and then explode and distribute the heavier elements into space. So the next generation of stars has some of these heavier elements. And that's why secularists say we're all made of star stuff, because they believe the heavy elements in our body, like oxygen, were once produced in a star. Now, I happen to know that's false, because according to biblical creation, God made the earth on day one. It already had water on it. Water has oxygen in it. That's a heavy element. So I know that heavy elements existed before stars. Stars aren't made until day four, according to scripture. So I'm making different predictions than they made. But those were the predictions they made. You got it? Fewer galaxies at great distances, because it takes time for them to form, and you shouldn't find any beyond redshift 14. The farthest ones you do find should be low mass, clumpy, baby galaxies, and they should have no heavy elements, nothing like oxygen or carbon. And this was back in 2022. I decided I'm going to make some predictions too, based on biblical creation. And so I made these predictions. I predicted that there's lots of galaxies at great distances, because I don't believe galaxies take time to form. I believe God spoke them into existence on day four. And so I think they'll find galaxies at distances even beyond redshift 14, and lots of them. And I don't believe that galaxies evolve. I believe God spoke them into existence as adults, like he did Adam and Eve. And so I don't expect baby galaxies. I expect the farthest galaxies they find will be fully formed, massive, well-structured. And because I know oxygen existed before the stars, according to scripture, I'm predicting that those farthest galaxies will have heavy elements in them, because I reject the Big Bang. So basically, my predictions are the exact opposite of what the secularists were predicting. And I'm confident enough in scripture that I would be right and the secularists would be wrong, that I decided I'll even predict how they will respond when their predictions fail. And so I predicted that secularists will respond to their failed predictions with statements like, Webb discovers that galaxies formed much earlier than previously thought. Because I think they're going to find them out at greater distances, right? But rather than give up the Big Bang, they'll say, well, I guess galaxies form really super quickly then. Because they're forming very shortly after the Big Bang, apparently. Well, anyway, you can check that I made those predictions back, because I wrote them on the website, Biblical Science Institute, January 21st, 2022. The article's still up. Well, that was before James Webb had released any data. And then it was in July of 2022 when we got the first images back of deep space in the James Webb Space Telescope. What did it find? Did it find that, yep, galaxies stop at a certain point? No, here's what it found. Galaxies upon galaxies upon galaxies upon galaxies at tremendous distances. Those are galaxies you're seeing there, and they're just beautiful. At galaxies, at distances that the secularists were not expecting. So what did they find? They found lots of galaxies at distances even beyond redshift of 14. Some of the estimates go up to a redshift of 20. That just blows away their predictions. But it's consistent with what we creationists were expecting. The farthest galaxies they found are fully formed. They're massive and well-structured. They're like, where are the baby galaxies? They're not there. You find fully formed, massive, even spiral galaxies, disk galaxies. That's supposed to take time to form, not if God speaks into existence. And the James Webb Space Telescope is able to detect substances in these galaxies, and it found heavy elements, things like oxygen, carbon, stuff like that. So the secular predictions were wrong. The creationist predictions were spot on. But what about my prediction of how they would respond? Remember, I predicted they would say things like, Webb discovers that galaxies formed much earlier than previously thought. How did they respond? Galaxies started forming much earlier than many astronomers previously thought. That's from UConn Today, August 9, 2022. How about that? Here's another one. Massive galaxies formed earlier in the universe than previously known. That's Nature News, July 27, 2022. Evidence is building that the first galaxies formed earlier than expected. Sky and Telescope, January 10, 2023. How about that? Folks, if you want to get the right answer, start with the Bible. See, I think it's neat that we can make predictions not only what we're going to find in space, but how human beings will respond to it, because the Bible tells us something about space, and it tells us something about human nature. It tells us that men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. And so people are very resistant to accepting what the Bible says. That's why I was able to make those predictions. Anyway, 2022 was a fun year. It really was. So what you're seeing there are just a small section of the hundreds of billions of galaxies in our universe. Every one of those little smudges you see there has probably 100 billion stars in it. And I love the way the Bible describes the creation of all these hundreds of billions of galaxies with hundreds of billions of stars each. It's summed up in this little phrase, "He made the stars also." Isn't that neat? Almost like an afterthought. Like, you know, it would go really good with the Earth. How about 100 billion galaxies with 100 billion stars? Why not? And it's just so casual. So the universe certainly declares God's glory. It's not consistent with the Big Bang, and we're seeing data from James Webb that is totally inconsistent with the Big Bang. All those folks who compromised, they have egg on their face now. Should have stuck with God's word. What about the basics of astronomy? Things you'd learn in any freshman-level astronomy class? The interesting thing about that is that the Bible's always right about astronomy, and even in cases where at the time the statement was written, people would have declared the Bible wrong. And now we know it's right. Let me give you some examples of this. You'll see where I'm going with this. The shape of the Earth. The Bible describes the Earth's shape as, in particular, having a circular terminator, which means the world is spherical. Job 26:10 says that he, that is God, has inscribed a circle on the surface of the waters at the boundary of light and darkness. Now, what's he talking about there? The boundary of light and darkness is what astronomers call the terminator. That's where evening and morning are occurring. And it's primarily on the waters because Earth's surface is mostly water, right? And it is, in fact, a circle. And the only shape that will always produce a circular terminator, no matter how you turn it, is a sphere. So I think that's pretty neat. The Bible in Job 26:10 refers to the terminator where light and darkness meet as circular. It's mentioned in the Proverbs too, Proverbs 8, I believe. So I think that's pretty neat that Job 26:10 teaches that the boundary between light and darkness is a circle, and that's only possible on a spherical world. So Job, which by the way we think is the oldest book of the Bible actually, we think it was written around 2000 BC. Genesis records earlier events, but Moses wrote it later. I think that's neat that the earliest book of the Bible refers to a round earth at a time when, as far as I can tell, none of the pagans believed that. They all thought it was flat. I think that's interesting. Job, again, written around 2000 BC. When did the secularists finally catch up? It wasn't until around 500 BC. Before then, all pagan cultures, as far as I can tell, believed the earth was a flat disk. Around 500 BC, Pythagoras, the Greeks, started thinking, you know, maybe the earth's spherical. And Aristotle is usually considered the first to prove that the world's round, which is easy to do, by the way, today, especially with modern equipment. But he realized by the shadow of the earth on the moon during a lunar eclipse that the earth would have to be spherical. It couldn't just be a disc, because depending on the orientation, sometimes it would look like a line instead of a circle. But it's always circular, and that only works with a sphere. By the way, the idea that Christopher Columbus was out to prove that the world was round is a myth. Educated people knew the world was round at the time of Columbus. He just thought it'd be faster to go that way, which it turns out it isn't. Although I am glad he made the trip. Earth floats in space. The Bible describes God hanging the earth on something on nothing. Well, you can't, but God can, and he did. And we have pictures of it today. It's a wonderful poetic description of the nature of the earth being suspended in space, literally hanging on nothing. I think that's wonderful. Now, that would have been hard to believe, perhaps, when it was written, because most of the secular cultures taught that the earth was a flat disk and floated in water. And frankly, that's more intuitive, because we've seen things float in water. We understand buoyancy. But you can't hang something on nothing. Well, yeah, God can, and he did. The Bible is exactly right. I have to wonder if there were some people who said, well, I know the Bible says God hangs the earth on nothing, but our best scholars say it's a flat disk and floats in water. The Bible can't be literally true there. I don't know if that happened, but if it did, they have egg on their face now, because the Bible was exactly right. The Bible teaches what I believe is an expansion of the universe, or at least the idea that the galaxies are moving away from each other. The Bible says in Isaiah 40:22 that God stretches out the heavens like a curtain, spreads them out like a tent to dwell in. What would that look like? Well, if the universe started like that, when God first spoke the galaxies into existence, and then he stretched them out, then it would look like this today, wouldn't it? They would be farther apart in distance than they were at creation. And lo and behold, there's good evidence that's happening. This was discovered in the 1920s, that galaxies all appear to be moving away from each other and from us. And the farther away they are, the faster they're moving away. It's as if the entire universe is expanding or being stretched out, just like the Bible teaches. Isn't that fascinating? And the only way you could discover this Hubble law by scientific means, you need to have modern instruments. You need to have a telescope, and you need to have a spectroscope to measure the redshifts, which we infer to be like a Doppler shift. It's moving away, right? And the telescope wasn't invented until 1608. Spectroscope wasn't invented until around 1814. So how did the ancient Israelites know that God was spreading out the universe? It's almost like they had some kind of divine insight into the issue, which of course they did, because God revealed that to them. Now, by the way, some people have asked, well, you know, if the universe is being stretched out, if the galaxies are moving further away from each other, doesn't that mean that if you run it back, they were all at one point, at one time? Doesn't that mean the universe exploded into existence 13.8 billion years ago? No. Just because something is bigger now than it used to be doesn't mean it exploded into existence 13.8 billion years ago. Some of you are bigger than you used to be. That doesn't mean you exploded into existence 13.8 billion years ago. Apparently, God made the universe with some size already. There's no evidence it was ever a point. And then he stretched it out since then, and that's what we call the Hubble law. And some people say, well, doesn't this at least count as evidence for the Big Bang? Because didn't the Big Bang predict this expansion? No. This expansion was discovered in the 1920s. The Big Bang came along in 1931 as a naturalistic explanation for that expansion. George Lemaître, the inventor of the Big Bang, he already knew that the galaxies were moving away from each other. He just thought, well, maybe it started from zero, which is an arbitrary conjecture. There's no good evidence for that. Conservation of mass and energy. The Bible teaches, I believe, this principle that the amount of stuff in the universe is constant, what we might call mass or energy. Einstein tells us mass and energy are really the same thing, measured in different ways. And we would expect that the amount of stuff in the universe is constant because God has ended his... God's not making new stuff, at least in terms of this universe, right? Because God ended his work of creation, the Bible says in Genesis 2:2. By the end of that sixth day, God finished his work of creation. He's done creating new stuff. And all things are made by him. So that means no new material is going to come into existence, because either it would mean God's still creating, which cannot be because he ended his work of creation. God's still working. He's working on a new creation, but he's finished with this one, in terms of the stuff anyway. And then, or it would mean that new stuff can come into existence apart from God, which cannot be because all things are made by him. Now, does this eliminate miracles? Well, no. I mean, God can make an exception if he wants to. If he wants to multiply loaves and fish, he can do that. He can increase the mass a little bit of the universe. It's not a problem. But in terms of the normal way God upholds his creation, he's not making new stuff anymore. Furthermore, God upholds what he made. So stuff is not going to cease to exist because Christ upholds all things by the word of his power. And in him, all things hold together or consist. So that would mean no material ceases to exist. Pretty neat. The amount of mass energy in the universe is constant. You can move it from one place to another. You can transform one kind of energy into another, but you can't make brand new energy, and you can't get rid of energy. It always goes somewhere. Those two principles together, conservation of mass or conservation of energy. Now, again, this is very early on. Genesis, we think, is around 1400s BC is when Moses wrote it. And so that was quite a long time ago. The other passages are New Testament, so they're all first century. When were these principles discovered by scientific means? Much, much later. Much later. Conservation of mass is usually attributed to the year 1785, something like that. Conservation of energy usually is credited to either Mayer or Joule around 1842. They both independently kind of discovered that. But Joel was, you could tell he was motivated by Scripture. He pointed out in his experiments where the energy in is always the energy out. He says, well, that makes sense because God's done creating. So he apparently had a biblical worldview, and that helped him in his science. It always does. Then Einstein proves that mass and energy really are the same thing, measured in different ways. That was 1905. So again, the Bible's talking about this thousands of years earlier. I think that's pretty neat. The Bible's not a science textbook, but because it's inspired by God, when it occasionally gives some insight into science, it's exactly right. Innumerable stars, countless numbers of stars. The Bible describes Abraham's descendants as humanly uncountable, as the stars of heaven and as the sand which is on the seashore, which is an analogy for a humanly uncountable number. And the Bible says that, which is too great to be numbered by us, is the implication. God does number the stars and has a name for each one, but we can't count the number of stars. Now, that's a pretty good analogy, isn't it, for an uncountable number, like the stars of heaven or the sand on the seashore. But it might not have seemed like such a great analogy when it was first created. I mean, the sand on the seashore, certainly, but the number of stars you can see naked eye, I mean, there's a lot, but a few thousand maybe? Somewhere between 3,000 and 10,000 is the number of stars you can see naked eye if you stay up all night and count them all. Depending how good your vision is, of course. Now, 10,000, that's a big number, but you could count to 10,000. It'd be tedious, but you could do it. And then the telescope was invented in 1608. And in 1610, Galileo made his own telescope. If you wanted a telescope, you had to make one back then. You couldn't go to Walmart, right? By the way, don't buy a telescope at Walmart. Yeah, okay. Anyway, Galileo used his telescope, and he pointed it up at the Milky Way, that cloudy band that you see in the summer sky, and found that, wow, that's not just a cloudy band, it's hundreds of billions of stars. And that is humanly uncountable. We can't even count the number of stars in our own galaxy. We can estimate it, but that's it. And we think there's at least that many galaxies now. Wow, great analogy. Great analogy. So have you learned the lesson of history? Because whenever the experts of the day have disagreed with the Bible's always turned out to be right. There was a time when every pagan culture on earth thought the earth was flat. And Job says, no, it's spherical. The terminator's circular. Those experts were wrong. The Bible was right. There was a time when people thought the earth floated in water. The Bible says it hangs on nothing. The Bible was right. There was a time when people thought new stuff could come into existence. The Bible says, nope, God's done creating. The Bible was right. There was a time when people thought the universe was static and couldn't expand or shrink. The Bible says God's stretching it out. The Bible was right. You get the point? All the experts of the day are what we call wrong. They are. They have ink on their face now. The Bible was right. They were wrong. Have we learned that lesson? Not everyone's learned that lesson. I hope you have. But not everyone has. And one area where secularists would say, okay, we'll grant you the earth's round, the Bible got that one right, but it's definitely wrong about, is this topic, the age of the cosmos. Because secularists believe the cosmos is billions of years old. 13.8 billion years is the latest number. That number does change from time to time. There was a time when it was 20 billion years, and then it was 15 billion years for a while, and then it was 13.7 for a while, and now it's 13.8. And there's some people arguing now that it's twice that old, so. Which would mean the previous estimate was wrong, right? But you gotta believe the new one, apparently. Well, the Bible is right when it addresses the age of the universe, just like it addresses anything. And we covered, if you were here this morning, we covered that the Bible is clear that God created in 6 days, and that was a few thousand years ago. The universe is something like 6,000 years old, based on, you know, the way we would measure it with Earth clocks and so on. And what I want to show you is that the science is consistent with that. But how do we do that? Because science, you can't scientifically measure the age of something, you realize. Age is a concept. It's a concept of the time now minus the time of the origin of whatever. And that, you know, that's a number. It's something that's tangible. It's not like you can scan a rock with your tricorder and measure the ageicles and it'll tell you the age. It doesn't work that way. Usually what happens when scientists make an age estimate of something is they look at some kind of process that is changing at a known rate. And then they figure, well, it probably started like this, and it's this far along, we know the rate, and then they do a little calculation to figure that out. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's just you have to be very careful about the assumptions that you make. Now, one of the most powerful ways to refute a faulty worldview is with what we call an internal critique. And when creationists like myself give scientific evidence for a young universe or young Earth, this is normally the way we do it. I want to be clear about this. What you do with an internal critique is you temporarily, as a hypothetical, accept the assumptions of your opponent and then show that they lead to an inconsistency. So what are the assumptions that secularists use to get the billions of years? There are primarily two. One, they assume naturalism. Naturalism is the belief that nature is all there is. If there's a God, he's within the universe. He's not transcendent to it. So I would reject naturalism, and so should you. But that's what they accept. They would immediately reject the idea that the universe was supernaturally created, because that's against their assumption of naturalism. And then the other assumption that they tend to make is uniformitarianism. Uniformitarianism is the belief that the present is the key to the past, that present rates and conditions are like past rates and conditions. And so if a canyon is eroding at 1 inch per year today, it must have been eroding at 1 inch per year 1,000 years ago, or 10,000 years ago, or 1 million years ago. And see, that assumption, I would argue, is wrong in many instances. Canyons, for example, the Great Flood would have carved lots of canyons quickly. We know that can happen. Mount St. Helens carved a canyon 1/40th the scale of the Grand Canyon in a matter of hours. It's, you know, just one volcano. Anyway, so I would reject those two assumptions. But what I can do is I can, for the sake of argument, accept them and show that in many cases they still lead to an answer that's much less than the secularist assumed age for the Earth or the universe. So you see how that works? That's an internal critique. So I have to say that because sometimes people say, but you assumed their assumptions. Yes, that's the point. It's not that I actually believe those assumptions. I just want to show they lead to an inconsistency. Because then what are they going to do? I've used their assumptions. If they, it is, well, I'm going to have to give up that assumption. Well, then you give up any evidence of an old universe anyway, you see. Jesus often used this technique when he was debating with his critics, and he was very good at it. So it's a good technique to study. Anyway, internal heat from Jupiter, for example. If we make the secular assumptions that Jupiter was not supernaturally created and that it's always been giving off energy like it does now, that leads to a problem. Because Jupiter gives off 2.13 times as much energy as it receives from the sun. So it gets one unit of energy, gives away two. Every second of every day, gets one unit, gives away two. Kind of like our federal government, right? Yeah. And like our federal government, it can't do that forever. Because eventually it's going to run out of energy. It's getting one unit of energy, it's giving away two, which means Jupiter is constantly losing energy. That's called internal heat. And if Jupiter were really billions of years old, it should have run out of heat a long time ago. That's a problem in the secular view. It's kind of like if you take a potato out of the microwave, you've just nuked it. You can feel the heat coming off of it, right? That's radiative transfer. You can feel the energy coming from it. If you come back 2 hours later, is it still nice and warm? No, it's lost all that energy. Things in the universe tend to come to an equilibrium temperature. Jupiter's no exception. If it were really billions of years old, it should have, cooled off by now, but it still has a lot of internal heat, internal energy. Now, Jupiter's a much bigger potato, and so it can do that for thousands of years. It's not a problem, but if it's billions of years old, it's a huge problem. The problem's even worse for Neptune, which gives off something like 2.6 times as much energy as it receives from the sun, and it can't hold as much energy because it's smaller than Jupiter. So there you go. That's a problem for the billions of years. Earth's magnetic field is decaying at a rate that, if we assume uniformitarianism, that it's an exponential decay. It's what we'd expect. And an exponential decay, right, is like, it starts out decaying quickly and then it kind of gets slower and slower and slower. And many decays in nature are exponential. It's a very natural way to decay. We'd expect that. The evidence is consistent with that. If you run it back to creation 6,000 years ago, the magnetic field would have been about 20 times stronger than it is today. We'd expect that. Magnetic fields are caused by electrical current, so there's current in Earth's core and maybe some in the mantle, and that's what creates that magnetic field. But those electrons encounter resistance. They run down. Batteries run down with time, and so that magnetic field is decaying. We've been able to measure this for the last almost two centuries. The magnetic field of Earth is decaying. We can measure that. And if we run it back to creation, it would have been 20 times stronger. But if you run it back 60,000 years, the magnetic field would have been so strong, it would rip the atoms of your body apart. You don't want that. And that's a problem because in the secular view, life is supposed to have been on Earth for about 3 billion years. But wait a minute, you can't even have atoms if you go back more than about 60,000 years because the magnetic field would be stronger than that of a neutron star. So that's a pretty tight constraint. Now they could save it by saying, well, we'll give up this idea that the past rate's like today's rate. Well, then you lose any evidence for your millions of years anyway, because all the other millions of years lines of argumentation assume that. It's not just the Earth. Some of the other planets of the solar system have magnetic fields. Jupiter has a very powerful magnetic field. It shouldn't be there if it's billions of years old. It should have decayed away by now. The magnetic fields of Uranus and Neptune, likewise. They should be dead if they were billions of years old. It was a surprise for the secularists when Voyager 2 flew past Uranus in 1986 and detected a magnetic field around it. But by the way, creationists predicted that. Russ Humphreys predicted in 1984 that Uranus would have a magnetic field. And he calculated its approximate strength based on 6,000 years of decay. Isn't that neat? You start with the Bible, you get the right answer. He did the same for Neptune, by the way, and it also worked out. Lunar recession. The moon is actually moving away from the Earth due to tidal forces. You probably know the moon causes tides. It pulls on the Earth's oceans. So you get one lump on the moon side. You get another lump on the opposite side because it's pulling the Earth away from that ocean. That's the way to think about that. So you get two tidal bulges as your high tides. But the Earth's rotating, and it rotates faster than the moon orbits and in the same direction. So those tidal bulges actually get ahead of the moon and they pull forward on it because they're ahead of the moon. And when you pull forward on something in orbit, it moves out. It's a little counterintuitive, but the moon's gaining energy. It's stealing a little bit of energy from Earth's rotation and moving away from the Earth as a result of that. And we can measure that because we left reflectors on the moon when the astronauts went there, and we can bounce a laser off of them and time the distance and get the distance to the moon within a fraction of an inch. And we know that the moon moves away from the Earth about an inch and a half every year. It's not very much. In fact, if you run that back 6,000 years, the Earth would have been 750 feet closer to the Earth, not even a mile difference. So it doesn't make much difference if they're 6,000 years old. But if you run it back billions of years, and you have to do the math right, because if the moon's closer to the Earth, then the tidal bulges would be even bigger, which means the speed would be faster, wouldn't it? And so you actually have to do calculus to get the right answer there. But if we make the secular assumptions and assume it's always been that way, and you run the equation backward, which I've done, you find that the Earth and Moon would have been touching 1.45 billion years in a hypothetical past. They would have been in the same place at the same time, which you can't have, right? So now you say, well, that's a long time, 1.45 billion years. Yeah, but the Earth and Moon are supposed to be 4.5 billion years old. But that's their upper limit on their age is 1.45 billion years just based on their separation. So see, that's a problem. It's an inconsistency in the secular view. Comets, which are made of ice and dirt and orbit the sun in elliptical paths, coming close to the sun and going back out, comets don't last millions of years because they're made of ice. And every time they come close to the sun, some of that icy material is blasted away. That's what makes a comet's tail or tails. Sometimes it has two, an ion tail and a dust tail. But that's material leaving the comet. They don't last millions of years. I've seen comets that have gone behind the sun and no longer exist. They've been completely destroyed in one visible pass. They don't last millions of years, folks. And my secular colleagues say, well, there's an Oort cloud that makes new comets. But there's no evidence for that. As far as we can tell, comets just reflect a young solar system. Pluto has all kinds of evidence of youth on its surface. The secularists were expecting it would be just an old cratered world, because Pluto's only two-thirds the size of Earth's moon. So it can't retain much heat, and it's 40 times farther away from the sun than Earth is, so it's not getting much energy from the sun. It can't have any kind of geology, mountains or canyons. It should be totally covered with craters by everything out there that's hit it over 4.5 billion years. But in fact, Pluto does have mountains. It has some craters, but there are sections that have no craters, and it has mountains the size of the Rocky Mountains. Isn't that amazing? There's geology on Pluto, or at least there was. And Pluto's moon as well, Charon. Mountains, canyons. It can't be billions of years old. Those features would be eroded over billions of years by crater impacts, which you don't see very many of. Spiral galaxies. Spiral galaxies actually rotate differentially, meaning their inner portions rotate faster than their outer portions, which means over time, galaxies would become tighter and tighter and tighter. And so I ran a simulation. What would a galaxy look like if it were really 10 billion years old. Now, the number at the bottom is the number of million years. So after 200 million years, it looks like that. Twisted beyond recognition. Looks like an old-fashioned phonograph record in terms of the number of spirals there. We don't see galaxies like that. I didn't have to run it out to even 1 billion years because you can see it would be just a uniform disk at that point. But we don't see galaxies that have that real fine spiral structure. They've only wrapped a little bit. They're consistent with the biblical age, not billions of years. Blue stars can't last billions of years because they expend their fuel quickly. And and that's universally agreed upon, by the way. Secularists agree blue stars, if you see a blue star, it's young. It's not anywhere near billions of years old. But we got them everywhere in the universe. Secularists say, well, new ones have formed. But we've never seen that happen. No one's ever seen a star form. Gas in space tends to want to expand. It doesn't want to just magically collapse in on itself. Once you make a star, its gravity will hold it together. But getting that gas to contract is very challenging. So the age of the cosmos really is very consistent with what the Bible teaches, and the science confirms that. And then finally, the uniqueness of the Earth. The Bible's right that about the special nature of Earth. Earth is special in God's plan because it's the planet where God placed those creatures he made in his own image. That is a unique honor. That is a unique honor. You realize, according to Genesis, God spent 5 of the 6 creation days working the earth, shaping it and filling it. He took one day, that first Wednesday, and made everything else. All the other planets made on day 4. All the stars, galaxies, day 4. Earth, day 1. It's unique. And it's unique because God formed it to be inhabited. The Bible says that in Isaiah 45:18. He is the God who formed the earth and made it. He established it and did not create it a waste place, but formed it to be inhabited. That's the purpose of the earth, to house life. Earth's neighbors, not designed for life. The moon, there's a picture of the surface of the moon. Buzz Aldrin, who walked on the surface of the moon, second person to walk on the moon, called the moon a magnificent desolation. I think it's a wonderful phrase for it. It has a beauty to it, but it's a desolate beauty. You don't get the vivid color and all the life that you find on Earth, it's not there on the moon. It couldn't survive on the moon. Moon has no air, no water. It's a rock in space. Earth's neighbors. There was a time when secularists thought maybe Venus would have all kinds of exotic life on its surface. And they were free to speculate because Venus is permanently enshrouded in clouds. You can never see the surface. It's always nice to be an evolutionist when you can speculate unfettered by inconvenient data. Well, we now know the surface temperature of Venus is 900 degrees Fahrenheit, so you're not going to find lots of exotic life on its surface. And those clouds are made up of sulfuric acid-type compounds, and the atmospheric pressure would crush you like a tin can. So it's just a question of how you're going to die, which one's going to kill you first, and it will be quick. Whichever one kills you first, it'll be quick. So, and Mercury, 800 degrees at the surface. Mars is too cold. Temperature there is a bit too cold, and it doesn't have liquid water on its surface, as far as we know. It doesn't have the right kind of atmosphere. It's got a thin atmosphere of carbon dioxide, which you cannot breathe. So it's not designed for life either. It's kind of like Goldilocks and the Three Bears. Those ones are too hot, that one's too cold, Earth's just right. We'd expect that. It's the planet God formed to be inhabited, which is why I don't expect to find life out in space. I really don't. And I like science fiction, I really do. But the real universe, the one that God made, I don't expect that it has Vulcans and Klingons in it. And you got some theological issues to think through if you think otherwise. Because if you got nations out there, well, the Bible says God is made from one blood, all nations. Oh, all nations are descended from Adam. You can't have nations out in space. Well, maybe they're just little tribes or something like that. They can't be saved. The reason we're eligible for salvation is because we're related to Jesus. He can pay for our sins on the cross. You see, the Vulcans and Klingons are out of luck. Lieutenant Worf, he can't be saved because he's not related to Jesus. So that's a problem, you see. And people say, well, maybe Jesus went and became a Klingon and died for them too. No, the Bible says he died once for all. He's raised incorruptible, which means he's never going to die again. His moment of humiliation is over. Well, maybe the Klingons never sinned. Well, then they're suffering the effects of the curse that Adam committed. See, it's theologically, there's some problems there. So I don't really expect to find life out in space. I'll grant the Bible doesn't say there's not. But at the same time, the Bible does indicate that Earth is very special in God's eyes. The planet that God formed to be inhabited. The planet where he put the creatures made in his own image and redeemed them. Jim Irwin was an astronaut who walked on the moon and later became a Christian. And in fact, he went on some searches for Noah's Ark. He was a biblical creationist. I would like to have met him. He's with the Lord now. But he one time made a statement, something to the effect of this. It's the amazing thing is not that man walked on the moon, but that God walked on the earth. And I think that is amazing. I think it is. The earth really is very special. It's not just another planet. It's the one where God walked to save us from our sins. That's awesome. That's truly awesome. So I hope you've seen that astronomy does reveal creation. We have a number of resources I'd encourage you to check out. The one that goes along with a lot of the material I talked about today is called Taking Back Astronomy. That'll show you how to refute the Big Bang and the billions of years and stuff like that. It doesn't have the new James Webb Space Telescope stuff in it because that's very recent. But if I ever update it, I'll put that in too. Astronomy Reveals Creation, this presentation, an older version of it, we have that on DVD. Another book you might consider, Stargazer's Guide to the Night Sky. If you want to know how to find some of these lovely gems that we looked at, that book's going to show you how to do that. A lot of them you can see, you can see star clusters with binoculars if you know where to look. A lot of astronomy can be done with binoculars, or if you get a small telescope, what kind you might want to get, how to use it, it's all in there. Or just naked eye stuff, if you want to know when the next meteor shower is, or when the next solar eclipse is. Things like that. It's all in that book. So that's Stargazer's Guide to the Night Sky. Physics of Einstein. If you want to learn about how God got the light from those galaxies to Earth in the biblical time scale, there's a book that covers that and a lot of other stuff like black holes and time travel and things like that. Truth is stranger than fiction. God made a really interesting universe, and it's not always what we'd expect it to be. Keeping Faith in an Age of Reason answers over 400 alleged Bible contradictions. And shows you that the Bible is a self-consistent document. It really is inspired by God. There's no contradictions there. But it's nice to have that on your shelf if anybody asks. It's indexed, so you can look it up. Introduction to Logic, How to Use Your Mind Rightly to the Glory of God. And to avoid being fooled by errors in reasoning. About half the book is how to avoid being fooled by errors in reasoning. That's a valuable skill. Secret Code of Creation, how God has built beauty into an aspect of creation most people have never even thought about, and it is amazing. This is my personal favorite of our DVDs, and well, we have a Blu-ray as well. And Fractals, The Secret Code of Creation, the book on that same topic. Do sign up for our free monthly newsletter. Make sure you put your email address, because it's an electronic newsletter, and we just want to bless you. And check us out on the website as well, Biblical Science Institute. That's a great website, a lot of free information on there. If you wanted to donate to us, we'd appreciate that. It's on the website. But if not, you know, a lot of free information on that website, a lot of articles. I try to get an article up at least every other week. And we're doing a series now on how do we know what we know in outer space? Like, how do we know what stars are made of is the latest article. So that's kind of interesting information and good to know. So I want to thank you again for having me out to speak. It's been a real pleasure. So God bless. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Lisle. What a great presentation again. I look at all you guys, you know what you are? You're a bunch of extraterrestrial, okay? Just kidding. So thank you. I mean, two wonderful teachings, morning and evening. Thank you for all coming out. But again, we're going to close with a word of prayer. Again, we always get that opportunity to accept Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you don't know him, get to know him. We're not promised tomorrow. I say this so often, and I think sometimes we don't take that seriously, but we never know when we're going to take our last step on this earth. The most important thing is that you know when you take that last step and you take your last breath that you're going to be in heaven. You know that old saying, last breath here on earth, and you'll take your first breath when you stand before our King of Kings, Lord of Lords. So will you bow with me? Let's close with a word of prayer. Father, we are so thankful for Dr. Lisle coming out to Hawaii and sharing a wonderful presentation this morning on Genesis and now talking about astronomy and the planets and galaxies. So full and yet so important for us to understand these things in relation to creation and to the God that we serve. And if you're here, and we are grateful once again that our church doors are open to those who would like to come in and hear the word of God and being taught, but most importantly, to understand that the fact that you have an opportunity to give your life to Christ. And so as we close in prayer and we end tonight's service, if that's you and you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, if you would like to, then I'm going to ask you to do one thing, just acknowledge by raising your hand. Anybody here before we close, you don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior. And Father, you see all the hearts that are here tonight. May you guide them, be with them through the week. Open doors for them to be a witness and to be a light of Jesus Christ in a dark world that is looking for hope, and we have those answers. So, Father, as we go our way, grant traveling mercies. We pray that you get Dr. Lisle home safely to Colorado and the rest of his itinerary through the year as he speaks in different locations. May you bless him, guide him by the Spirit, allow his words to make an impact, teaching these truths to a world and to a generation of people that need to hear it. We love you, Lord. We thank you for tonight. All glory goes to you. So we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. One last song. Will you please rise, and we'll let you go on your way.
Something isn't adding up. This wild exchange you offer us. Gave my words, you gave your blood. Seems hard to believe. You're telling me you chose the cross. You're telling me I'm worth that much. If that's the measure of your love, how else would I sing that I'm completely, deeply, so sincerely abandoned. I'm completely, freely, hands to the ceiling in ever. My one life endeavor to match your surrender, to mirror not my will but yours. I'm completely, deeply, don't care. Oh, I surrender all. my life, each breath in my lungs, consider it yours, Lord. Consider it yours, Lord. The failures I hide, the victories I don't, the battles I fight, each crown that I hold, consider it.
God bless. Go for God. Have a great week.